Welcome to Sunny Brae Baptist Church. We're thrilled that you've decided to join us this week for another virtual service. Because although we can't be together, it's great that we can still stick together in these little ways through watching these at the same time and still communicating with each other. We have lots to look forward to, even so, as we're looking to having our virtual VBS. We have house churches coming soon, and we continue doing Zoom meetings and Zoom Bible studies online. Also, you can do your part just by liking and sharing and spreading this message and spreading the word to help us to continue to reach more people than ever before. So, without further ado, let's get started.
Hi, I'm Christy.
And I'm Wes. And we're here to talk to you about Focus VBS coming up in July.
Awesome.
When does it start, Christy?
And it starts Monday, July 13th, and it's happening every Monday for 5 weeks.
So for 5 weeks, a new video will come out every Monday. It'll have crafts and games and things that you can interact with.
We're going to show you how to do the craft and how to play the game.
And we'll have a new video for you every week as well, so you can join us as we learn along with you for Focus VBS. In the link below this video, there's going to be a registration form for VBS. If you haven't signed up already, please do that, because
we are going to be handing out a pizza box with all the crafts and all the materials that you need for each week. We'll put them in each bag for each week, and then you'll have everything that you need to be able to play the crafts you need.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So please join us this summer for our online virtual VBS. Although we can't all hang out in this room together, we can still do the same things, the same activities online.
We are so looking forward to sharing this experience with you.
Awesome. Let's do it.
Through you, the blind will see. Through you, the mute will see. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who stray. Come sit at the table and come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that it endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't endure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, Mother of God, oh, you're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart. Come as you are, come as you are. Fall in His arms, come as you are. There's joy for the morning, O sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame.
Today we're going to carry on in this series called Life Interrupted, and we're going to take a little change from what it has been so far. We've been looking at biblical characters, we've been talking about ways that their lives have been interrupted and the impact from that. Today we're going to change focus. I had a sermon mostly planned out. It was going to talk about Abraham and his journey of fatherhood and how his life was interrupted, and I was going to relate that to our own journeys as fathers on this Father's Day, and talk about ways that our lives can be interrupted. But about just a couple of hours before recording this today, God kind of just laid on my heart that He wanted to go in a different direction with today's message, and so we're going to do that. We're still going to be talking about people's lives who were interrupted, but it's a very different look than what we have been doing. We're going to go back in some Canadian history, in fact, some Atlantic Canadian history, and talk about events that happened on December 6th, 1917. Perhaps for some of you, as soon as I say that date, you know what I'm going to be referring to. For others, that date may not mean quite as much yet. But I want to talk about an event that happened in the city of Halifax. It's known today as the Halifax Explosion, and just the terrible events that happened around this. But we want to talk a little bit about the events that led up to and what happened and how this happened. And I think we'll see that perhaps God has something in store for us all to hear from this. So on December the 5th, 1917, there were two particular boats in and around the Halifax Harbor that we're going to be talking about through this that I want to just describe what was happening. On December the 5th, the nets went up. They're called the submarine nets. They would go up at the Halifax Harbor to stop any submarines from being able to get in to the Bedford Basin and through what's called the Narrows. And if you look on the screen, you'll see that there's a depiction of the Bedford Basin, the Narrows, and the Halifax Harbor. Out in the Halifax Harbor, there was a boat called the Mont Blanc. The Mont Blanc was a French ship that was coming from New York
going into the Halifax Harbor to meet up with some other ships that were then going to go over to France, carrying with it explosives that they were taking in the war efforts to help fight the war. In the Bedford Basin, there was another ship that was anxious to leave. They were on their way to New York to pick up supplies. It was a Norwegian ship called the Emo, and they were picking up supplies to take back to in Belgium relief efforts. There was just war-torn parts of Europe, of course, and so they were bringing relief. They wanted to bring relief to help in this cause. Both ships, both being engaged in terms of being used for war or to help with war, both in and around the Halifax Harbor on this day. On the morning of the 6th, when the nets were taken away so that boats could pass, the Mont Blanc was on its way from outside in the harbor, coming into the Narrows on its way to the Bedford Basin, and the Emo was in the Bedford Basin starting its journey out toward the Halifax Harbor and then on to New York. As the Emo is leaving the Bedford Basin, there is another small ship that is just coming out of the Narrows, and normally what would happen is these two ships would pass through the Narrows on port side. They would pass carefully, making sure that everything was okay and not to engage each other in any way, and this happens regularly. But on this particular morning, this smaller ship was leaving, and the Emo had to take a wide berth, a wide turn out and around. And so now they are on the Dartmouth side of the Narrows. And as they are approaching, from some distance off, the two ships began to recognize there's another ship in my path. The Mont Blanc, they gave a one toot on the whistle, one blow of the horn. And this meant, I'm in my lane, you need to move. To their surprise, the Emo came back with two toots of the whistle or blows of the horn. And that meant, no, I'm staying my course, you need to move. This happens quite often as ships are passing, and it's just trying to make sure that each one knows who's going to move and who needs to be in the place they are. The Emo continued on their course, and they were moving quite fast. They had no cargo on their ship. The Mont Blanc did have cargo, and we're going to talk about that cargo after a little bit here, but the Mont Blanc carries on and again blows its horn. One blow of the horn, meaning I'm in my lane, you need to move. And again, to their shock, came back two blows of the horn from the Emo, meaning we are not moving, you need to do something. And as the two ships came closer, they quickly began to realize this is not heading in a good direction for us. So the captain of the Mont Blanc decided, now is when I need to cut the engines. I just need to stop the engines, and this will at least slow us down and we can see what happens. So they cut their engine. Eventually the Emo also cut their engines. But when the Mont Blanc cut their engines, the ship began to fade and just drift a little bit toward the Halifax side of the harbor. It was turning some. They lost the ability to really control too much. And just before the Emo had cut their engines, they had put reverse thrust on, and that caused it to shift as well. And eventually these two ships came together and they collided. When they collided, the Emo, the larger of the two ships, put about a 2 to 3 meter gash in the side of the Mont Blanc, which really is not that much damage. You fast forward 20 minutes later, and there is an explosion that rocks Halifax. In fact, this explosion, some of the details of this are really quite incredible as to the vastness and the heat and the power and energy caused by this explosion. They say that the blast wave that went out from this explosion traveled at a speed of 1 kilometer per second. And it just went out from the center where the explosion was, just went out in all directions, 1 kilometer per second. You could feel the tremors of this as far away as PEI and Nova Scotia. The heat generated from this went to 5,000 degrees Celsius. Now, just to give you an idea of what that means, the surface of the sun registers a heat of 5,500 degrees Celsius. So the heat generated from this explosion was nearly the same temperature as the surface of the sun. Buildings within a 2.6 kilometer radius were just demolished, just torn apart as shards of iron were flying, white hot iron were flying everywhere. You can actually go to Halifax today and you can see that on the opposite side, if you look at that map again of the Halifax Harbor, so there's the harbor, then there's Halifax itself. You'll see there's an inlet just south of Halifax. On the other side of that inlet, 2.5 kilometers from the blast, there was a piece of the anchor of the Mont Blanc, which weighed half a ton, that's where it landed. There was a gun at the front of the Mont Blanc that actually landed over 5 kilometers away north on the other side of Dartmouth. Just huge implications from this. Fires sprung up everywhere as stoves were turned and the gas was just lighting everywhere, and 2,000 people lost their lives. 9,000 more were injured. Devastating losses in terms of lives, finances, and of course, for everyone in the Halifax area at that time. Just an amazing and terrible impact on their life in that day. All from these two ships that were traveling toward each other. So I said we were going to talk about what was on the Mont Blanc, and this is actually what causes the explosion. The Mont Blanc was carrying cargo to help with the war. It was on its way back to France, and it was all explosives. It was carrying 227,000 kilograms of TNT. It was carrying 1.6 million kilograms of wet picric acid and 544,000 kilograms of dry picric acid. It was carrying 56,000 kilograms of gun cotton. And on the top, in barrels, it was carrying 223 kilograms of benzol. Now, benzol is actually what really truly started to create the biggest problem, because as this collision happened, the two ships collide, and this gas is put in, this benzol, which was being carried in barrels near the top of the ship, actually began to spill open, and benzol is quite flammable. And so it actually lit on fire, and now you have all of this benzol on fire on top of a ship carrying all of these other explosives. And soon enough, we see the very large explosion. 20 minutes it took for this to happen. There's a lot of stories that can go in and around, that do go in and around this one story of the explosion. There's a story of the crew of the Mont Blanc as they were leaving. They got in lifeboats, they were leaving. They're yelling and screaming at people to leave because they knew what they were carrying. Almost nobody else in Halifax knew what was on board the Mont Blanc. So as the crew is leaving, they're trying to get people's attention. They're yelling at them. No one can hear them because of all the chaos and confusion. There's boats that are coming toward. There's trains that are on their way into the city. And there's heroic stories of the man who stopped those trains. He risked his own life to go back to send the messages to the trains to say, do not come to this city. In fact, that man died. There's all kinds of stories that you can hear in and around this. But I want to focus on the fact that the Mont Blanc was carrying this cargo. You see, if these two ships just collide at sea, or they just collide in this harbor, and neither one has the explosive material in its cargo, then this explosion obviously does not happen to the degree that it happened here. And so as I've been reflecting on this just this afternoon, as I've been thinking about this and what God's been impressing on my heart, I guess one of the questions that I've wondered about is, have you ever had interactions with somebody, or perhaps they've had interactions with you, where something is said, something is done, and then there is a reaction? And that reaction seems to go far beyond anything that you would think from the, what I'll call the impact of the actual situation itself. Usually when that happens, usually when there is a situation and there's some type of maybe conflict or whatever it is that has happened between two people or two groups of people or whatever's happening, and then there's this explosion of a reaction, it is most, in most cases, not necessarily because of the impact of the collision of the conflict that has actually happened, but it's actually because of the cargo, of the load, of the burdens that are being carried. You see, as you look at in your own life and you understand that there are interactions that you've had with people, and perhaps you can think about times in your own life when somebody has said something to you, perhaps quite innocently. Maybe there's been this interaction that you've come back quite, I'll use the word violently, toward. And later on you wonder, why did I react the way I did? Why was I so passionate about this? Why did I respond in such a manner? Usually, when you begin to dig deep into what's going on, it's not actually about the interaction that happened, but it's about the burden of the cargo that you're carrying at that time. Perhaps when I talk about this, people begin to think about what's happening in the States right now. You begin to think about some of the uprising that's happening, some of the protests that are happening, and perhaps there are people who don't understand why this is all springing up in the way it is. Well, I can tell you with absolute certainty, because of the people I've talked to, friends that I've had conversations with, that there has been a burden that they've been carrying for a long time. But that isn't actually the focus of today's message. The focus of today's message is on the burdens that you may be carrying. Perhaps you've noticed as you look around our world today that there just seems to be a lot of people where reactions happen that don't fit the context of what has just happened, the situation. And those burdens that people are carrying, those burdens that you may be carrying, whether we know it or not, have an impact on everybody else around us. You see, as the Mont Blanc was coming and they knew that they were going to be engaged in this way by the emo, they knew that the cargo that they carried was going to impact many, many people. I think we need to begin to understand that the cargo that we carry, the burdens that we carry, the trials, the struggles, the sadness, the sorrow, all of it impacts us deeply. And it impacts others around us as we react and respond in various ways to them. I want to share some scripture with you. Matthew chapter 11, Jesus tells us, he says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy and my burden is light." Perhaps for many listening today, as you hear some of this story, you may kind of connect with it to say, you know what? I have been carrying burdens with me. I've been carrying a cargo with me that I just feel this burden is piling up on my back. And yeah, I feel like I could explode at any time. I feel like other people could feel the impact of the burdens that I carry on my back because I could just explode. In the book of Philippians, chapter 4, we read this. "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Here we have in these two passages, in the first one, Jesus saying, "Come to me if you're weary. Come to me." Because You can be yoked with me, and it is light, and I will give you rest. And here in Philippians, we see that there is a promise of a peace that passes understanding. There are several things that I believe Christ's followers should be marked by. One of those things that we need to be marked by is a peace, because we are able to come to God, we are able to come to Christ, and we are able to cast all of our cares. In 1 Peter chapter 5, he says, cast all your cares on him. And Jesus says, come to me if you are weary. I'll give you rest. In Philippians, it says just what we've read here, that there is a peace that passes understanding. And I believe that this peace that passes understanding is one of the things that needs to mark the follower of Christ. We can carry around our burdens. We can carry them around every day. And that passage in 1 Peter that says, cast all your cares on him, it's an active thing. It's an action that we do. We cast our cares on him. Now, when I hear the word cast, I automatically think of fishing. And when you fish, if you just stand there all day with your rod in your hand and ready to reel in whatever you've caught, but you never actually cast, you're not going to catch anything. And Peter says, cast all your cares on him. And it's an action. It is a verb that you must do. You cast your cares. But instead, what we so often like to do is we like to be full of pride and say, I've got to deal with this on my own. I've got to handle this. I've got to make my way through this. And we hate to burden anybody else, especially God. And so we never cast our cares on him. We never come to the one whose yoke is light. We never find the rest that he refers to. And we hear this thing called peace that passes understanding, and we can't even comprehend it. Because all the burdens keep mounting and piling up on our backs, and we're not prepared to cast them onto him. See, here's the thing about the burdens that we carry and the peace that passes understanding. Jesus doesn't promise that when we cast our cares on him, that he'll remove them from us. He doesn't promise that when we cast our cares on him, that all of it is taken away and we don't have to deal with any of it anymore. That's not what he promises us. He promises a peace that passes understanding. And that means that in the midst of all of the burdens that we can now put on his back, that we can have a peace in the middle of it. We can have a peace that doesn't even make sense when other people look at us and they see the burdens that are piling up and that should be on our backs, and they can see someone who has peace. That's why it passes understanding. It doesn't make sense that somebody who could have all the burdens of the world laid on their shoulder can have peace. But in Christ, we can have that when we learn to cast our cares on him, when we learn to be yoked with him. So how do we do this? Church, I want to suggest that it's time that we actually get real with Jesus. I think too many times we hold back. We hold back from being real with God. It's almost like we're afraid that if he sees the real us, that he'll run away because he'll be scared of what he sees. Trust me when I say he knows the real you more than you know the real you. He knows the real Colin more than I know the real Colin. And he's not run away yet. And so if I begin to be very real with him, and I really and truly start to cast my cares to the point where it's all I want to do, I want to cast those cares on him, then we can begin to see that peace that passes understanding. I'd like to illustrate this whole point of carrying our burdens and what it can do to us and the impact that it has on us. It'd be kind of like, let's view this book as a burden. And so I've got this burden that I've been carrying around, and you know what? This book by itself is not all that heavy, but over time it gets a little bit heavier as I carry it. And then every once in a while there's something else that gets added on, another burden. And now it's a little bit heavier, and I've got to carry this with me. And sometimes it's not only the burdens that, that I pick up on my own, but sometimes other people will come and they kind of lay burdens on you, and these burdens get heavier. And so we try to find a way to deal with this. And so maybe I can find something, some way to make this easier. So I'll go and I'll find a way to put my burdens. In something, some way to make it easier to carry. And so I throw them over my back. And I can even think, you know what? I've dealt with this. This is so much easier, so I've dealt with my burdens. But then more burdens come. And I start carrying more, and other people bring me more burdens, and sometimes they're really big, heavy burdens that we have to carry. And it all starts to get really, really heavy. And sometimes I'm thinking if there's too many more of these, I don't know what I'm gonna do, and it's heavy here, it's heavy everywhere. And more burdens come. And more burdens. And they get laid on me, and it just gets feeling overwhelming. And then you remember at the beginning we talked about how sometimes that one reaction that you get doesn't seem to fit the situation. Well, maybe it's just a small burden that comes, but added to the weight, it just becomes too much. And it all falls. It crumbles because we can't carry all of the burdens. We have to let them go. So what do we do with all of these burdens? You see, this whole time I was carrying the burdens, right in the background of me, you can see that the cross that we have here in our sanctuary is right there. It's kind of a reminder to me that the entire time I'm carrying my own burdens, that Jesus is right there with me. And he's asking, he's inviting me, he's saying, cast your cares on me. Come, let's tie our yoke together and you will find rest. So as we have all of these burdens that we're carrying around, I think what we need to understand, we need to do, is come, lay these burdens, put them all at Jesus' feet. Just lay them on Him. There is no burden too big that He can't handle. There's no burden that He can't take. We lay them at His feet, and we say, Jesus, I cast my cares on you. I want the peace that passes all understanding. This is available to you. It's available to all of us because of the work that Jesus Christ has already accomplished. The victory He's already won on the cross. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank You so much for the victory that You've won. We thank You for Your Son, for the cross. We thank You for the fact that He rose from the dead, conquering death, conquering hell, making it, God, so that we can find freedom. We can find peace and joy. We can come and lay our burdens at His feet. Father, help us to do that. Help us to learn how to constantly, continually cast our cares, our burdens, and our worries on Him. Thank You for Your love for us. We pray this all in Jesus' most wonderful, powerful, holy name. Amen.
I'm giving You my heart and all that is within. I lay it all down for the sake of You, my King. I'm giving You my dreams. I'm laying down my rights. Giving up my pride for the promise of new life. And I surrender all to You, all to You. And I surrender. Singing You this song,
Thank you again for joining us this week. And it's our hope and our prayer that we can all learn to lay our burdens down and leave those at the foot of the cross as we move forward with the freedom that Christ offers us. Have a great week, everyone.
I'm like, hands. What do you do with your hands? Hands, what do you do with your hands? You need a place for your hands. Yeah, it's true. Pew, 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 pew. And I was like, why am I doing this? It's hard to see with these on.
I don't know, it could be glare. From my head. Don't trip on anything.
Okay, and we're gonna high five?
Yeah, it's gonna be terrible.
Yeah, okay. Totally. As long as we know that beforehand, right?
When does it start, Christy?
July 13th. Is it July 13th?
I think so.
You think so? Okay. July 13th. Do you want more?
It was a very short answer.
It starts July
13th. Oh, sorry. I touched my face.
And it's happening every Monday for 5 weeks.
For 5 weeks?
Yeah.
That's a lot of time. That was terrible.
Yeah, it's going to be great. We're going to show you the games, and we're going to show you the games. Did I say games and games?
You did. Oh, there's a stool there.
Did you trip?
Almost. Don't trip on anything.
Yeah, you gotta be safe.